And welcome to the Lync 2013 Ignite Lync Updates and Programs, where we're talking right now about the network assessment methodologies in this course. My name is Aaron Steele, and I am a senior consultant. I've been joined today by Brian Ricks.
Hi, everyone. I'm Brian.
So I've been with Microsoft for about 3 years. I've been focused specifically on Lync and Enterprise Voice for most of that time. I've been with sort of dealing in Microsoft technologies for about the past 18 or so years, and I live in Chicago with my wife and two wonderful children.
Nice, and as mentioned, I'm Brian Ricks. I am the owner of a company named Brightcom Computers. We deal with infrastructure and needs kind of things, whatever it happens to be, whether it be Microsoft or not. I'm a unified communications architect and have been working with Microsoft Lync UC products since the LCS days, 2003, technically Exchange 2000, but LCS 2003, an MVP in Microsoft Lync since 2006, and a Microsoft certified master's in communications. I've been working in IT myself for about 20 years, from the help desk slash desk end user world on up, and have been independent since 2009.
So, setting some expectations about this course, we're really targeting it at IT and telecommunications professionals, especially those who are planning and designing Lync and UC products. You are expected to be experienced in Lync and wanting to really gain an understanding of what's coming and what has come since the RTM of the product. So we have some suggested courses here for you for Lync. And they are the 2336 and 2337 exam. And then part of what we'll be talking about in this relates to a partner exam, the 74-335 exam. You can go and get your get certified and, you know, prove that you know your stuff through the through those courses. And there's those courses you can take to then get those certifications.
Exams. Yay.
Exams. In this course, we'll be talking again about those network assessment methodologies. We'll just cover a brief introduction of what that sort of means and what we mean when we talk about a network assessment. We'll talk about the goals of that assessment, how you position it, and then we'll get into the different phases of that assessment from discovery through to modeling, traffic simulations, and then finally giving those recommendations, and then a brief recap of sort of what this all means to us. So from an introduction point of view, what is a network assessment? A network assessment is really about gauging the network impact versus the user experience of of your network and of your deployment. So it's about how does real-time communication or RTC traffic affect your network, that traffic being conferencing, voice, video, collaboration, and how does that affect real-time communication on your network? So how does your network conversely affect that communication?
And a network assessment is not a new thing, right? This is not something that just is a Lync-only endeavor. A network assessment could be done for a variety of reasons. This is simply we're saying you need to have one for Lync if you haven't recently to know what is on your network.
Right, and a lot of this is about understanding what the different pieces of your network are and how that network is being utilized and how that network is functioning before you start mixing voice traffic onto that network. Because remember, the technology is really only as good as the last call. Mm-hmm. So how to identify your need? Really, you can do it proactively, which is what we'd recommend, or you can do it reactively, and that's sort of reactively, are you or your customer having quality issues? One of the things you can use to solve those quality issues on calls is a network assessment to make sure that the network's not the cause of it.
Why are things failing? And it's very possible that after a network assessment, it's not the network. Or not. It's possible. It could be some other factor that's involved, whether it be endpoints or some other end-user training is sometimes one of the things. But the network assessment is to either rule in or rule out that the network has some issues.
Yeah, but from a proactive point of view, it's really about what are your plans for voice and video on your network? Determining, is your network ready for real-time or unified communications? Have you considered real-time or unified communications when you're planning and building your network? And what are the expectations on usage? It guides you through all of these phases, and these are some of the reasons you might choose to do a network assessment. So the network assessment, sort of as a phrase, is truly an offering that provides app-centric evaluation to pinpoint problems that could affect unified communications on your network. It is, when we say it's an offering, that means it is a fee-for-service that you can contract with Microsoft to come and perform on your behalf on your network to understand. And it's usually engaged or done as part of a Microsoft Consulting Services engagement to deploy enterprise voice or to deploy an additional feature set into your Lync deployment.
Now, can anyone do a network assessment, or is it specific to Microsoft and their abilities, or?
You could do a network assessment all on your own, purchase the tools, do it, whatever you want. This offering that we're talking about here is sort of that specific Microsoft specific one. It really, though, gets down to four phases. It goes in through the discovery session, where we discover all the data and try and figure out the modeling that we want to use for your environment. We then go into usage modeling. We go through a traffic simulation where we actually put traffic over your production network for a period of time. And lastly, we analyze all those pieces and come up with a set of recommendations. Those recommendations being to right size your network, apply quality of service, whatever the end result be. So when we're talking about the goals of a network assessment, it's really about being proactive rather than reactive. It's about understanding at an early phase discovery at an early phase about what potential future problems might show up. It's about assessing your network's readiness. In a traditional or legacy PBX environment, network assessments weren't as necessary because that PBX or that voice traffic was on a different network, be it a copper network or be it on a voice network. Once we've started intermixing Lync, the endpoints are the PCs. They don't have that opportunity to dump that traffic onto a different network.
All right, so from a very basic perspective on a PBX network, it was, do I get tone from A to B? And if so, if I can get it from this endpoint or this jack back to the PBX, it's gonna work. Because it was dedicated, right? They had their dedicated path to get that communication. And of course, we're sharing networks typically in a Lync deployment. So
most definitely. Yeah. So it is performing a layer 7 analysis. So that means we're assessing it all the way up the stack at the top layer, effectively inside of the application. So it will try to dive through and understand what factors all the way down that stack can impact your call quality. It will provide recommendations on a Lync deployment, and it will measure actual performance. That is, when we recommend this, we're recommending to run it for for at least 5 days worth of time during your production network. So when we're talking about benefits, we've just said you should do it. What are the reasons and the benefits to the customer for actually having done it or doing it? Again, or back to the point, it validates your readiness for real-time communication, so you're no longer guessing and sort of saying, yeah, my network can handle it.
Especially because that's often said, right? When we're going into engagements, oh, my network is plenty powerful. It's all set up. It's all good to go. And then if we go on that point, it very well may be. We're not saying that networks aren't capable and are ready to be in place with QoS.
But
and
this
everything.
Proves it.
This proves it and eliminates the finger pointing.
Yep. So. And it provides that quantitative assessment. So it's no longer a judgment call, is my network ready? It's actually a number that says, my network is ready to handle this many calls of this type at one time. It reduces the deployment risk, all in all, right? It makes it so that you're at a lower area of risk, a lower risk position. It does highlight areas that might have an impact on your readiness, right? It protects that investment that the customers are making in real-time communication. And it really does promote the best possible user experience by performing these tasks. When we're talking about positioning is how do you sort of tell your customers in your business, as if you are running your own business, why should you do a network assessment? The truth is, this should be part of every enterprise voice deployment. As you're rolling out voice into your network, any in fact enterprise voice, be it voice over IP from somebody else or voice over IP from Lync, you'll want to perform a network assessment of this. because a large percentage of voice support calls or support calls about voice are truly related to network impairments or network impediments. We can conduct these assessments when Lync is introduced, as new workloads are introduced. We can do it when new groups of user populations are enabled for Lync, or we can do it when QoS or quality of service is being introduced or adopted globally. So you have a number of different places where a trigger of some change in your environment can be the reason that you start doing and perform one of these network assessments.
And the key here is that it's when Lync is introduced, when new something this, when this is introduced, not after the fact, not
when
after things are broken.
Changes.
We want it to be proactive. We really do.
So your business opportunities around this network assessment are to discover your equipment. So you start to figure out the types, the models, the versions of your switches. You start to make sure that you can don't need to upgrade your network, don't need to configure your network, right? So you'll learn things like, hey, by the way, that core router you've got is set to strip QoS markings on all packets. So you're not getting end-to-end QoS between these two endpoints. It lets you evaluate your router and switch configuration. If you've got null routes defined, if you've got problems on the QoS layer, if you've got problems from a capacity perspective, it lets you troubleshoot network issues, and it validates any existing concerns you have. Right? But with that said, Microsoft isn't a network company. Right? We don't try to be one. We aren't trying to discover or inventory your network and every device on it, and we aren't necessarily going to tell you how to optimize your network, how to configure or troubleshoot core pieces of your network. We're going to tell you something happened. We're going to tell you the problem is X. We're not necessarily going to be the expert to tell you how to configure your network switch to change that. So we've got a few risks that are out there if you go down the point of not performing a network assessment. The biggest and sort of biggest reason for it is this idea that you could have a poor UC user experience. Bad calls that may or may not, in fact, get reported into your help desk. People may just simply deal with them and get frustrated at the poor perception of the technology and the product's ability to perform. You could also get saturated networks that impact your other line of business applications. If you don't do one of these and you end up pushing way more traffic than you expected across some of your core backbones, you may in fact impact your business's ability to do work outside of the, just making calls.
Right, and it's not uncommon for it to be reflexive either, where there are line of business applications that have weekly or monthly, end of month type processes that while looks good for 3 weeks, everything's functioning, every end of month, for whatever reason, everything starts to go into a poor state. And that could very well be that it is impacting Lync and or vice versa. Maybe the reports are taking longer to run. Not knowing, obviously the more data you have, the better decisions you can make, but not knowing or doing a Lync assessment introduces that risk of just not knowing. Not knowing what you don't know is just as bad as knowing it isn't going to work, right?
Yep. So. Generally, you just have a poor return on your UC investment. And then you have this additional sort of factor of reduced productivity and collaboration, right? Because you've impacted the user's ability to make calls, because you've impacted potentially your ability to do your line of business functions, you've overall reduced the capabilities of that end user. So for the first phase of this network assessment, we're calling it discovery. Really, the goals and objectives of discovery are really about coming up with the data that can be used to depict the factual state of the network. And the goals really behind that are to uncover current and future potential sources of network impairments, confirm the simulation probe placement choice, and ensuring network information is collected for calibration of usage models. What we mean by that is, this discovery phase is both to understand how you've architected your network, but also to validate and ensure that the assumptions we've made about where we're going to place these network devices and where we're going to do this work is the appropriate place for it to fit in your network. From a discovery perspective, the need for that is really about understanding your network. It's understanding how to collect your data for proper scoping and scaling. It's about building a usage model for the customer, not just guessing that that customer fits in the same usage model that Microsoft MSIT has deployed.
And by model, we'll get more into in the
the modeling.
The modeling section, which uses a tool that Microsoft has created. But think of modeling as everybody is a user of video in our
personas,
company.
Personas, we might
right,
say.
Right, the personas. And if it's 100%, that's going to be way different than majority of companies, but you need to account for such a thing for those
yep.
type of people.
Yeah, if you know that your users are going to be participating in a lot of multi-user video conferences,
that's different.
That's different than what a lot of other companies would deal with.
Right.
So this need for discovery, it helps you identify the risk elements that could impact your future Lync deployment. You can eliminate those last-minute surprises and often overlooked areas of your deployment. And you can bring those different groups together very possibly for the first time. You get your deep-level networking guys who understand your WAN traffic and your WAN optimization technologies with the guys who understand your Lync voice and where you plan to put those endpoints. This may be the first time that you got all those people in the same room such that the WAN guys tell the Lync guys that, oh, by the way, the end of that WAN can't have 30 voice endpoints on it.
Yeah, because of X.
Right. Yep, but right. Until they've gotten together and talked, you're never going to figure that out. So from a discovery point of view, what we discover are a network overview. We discover pieces about your WAN and about your LAN. We discover about your network sites. We discover your different WAN technologies and what those link speeds are. We figure out a bit of what LAN and or Wi-Fi technology you have in your enterprise. If you have any, we figure out what quality of service strategies you have in your environment. We determine what different PSTN ingress, egress connection points exist, what existing service level agreements exist on that WAN or that MAN. And we discover any historical metrics you have about that environment, not just what we're trying to pull in this discovery. We'll discover those usage profiles. We'll discover whether those are application sharing or conferencing, real-time applications being those IM, presence, voice, video, whatever it is, what your legacy voice architecture does and what your PSTN usage feeds into that. So how many calls you have coming in or going out to the PSTN can impact and be a factor of what we discover here. So the discovery phase is collecting that information. Is quality of service in place or QoS in place? If so, what type? Is there QoS on the WAN? Are there WAN SLAs? What's the percentage of traffic that can be reserved for UC traffic or for real-time communications? From a network topology perspective, how many sites do you have? What's the layer 2 and layer 3 resiliency at those sites? Do you log current utilization levels? It's entirely possible that during this phase you may discover that your customers simply don't log know. Their network.
Yeah, and it's not uncommon that people cannot give you historical data of what is going on in your network, how much of your pipe is used today, what's your peak utilization and your average. And unfortunately, not uncommon to not know. And so you may be gathering that in these upcoming phases for the first time.
Yep. So you can gather things like regional WAN bottlenecks. That is, are there multiple WAN providers? Do those WAN providers have regional bottlenecks of their own that you have to deal with? You have to discuss and figure out your firewall architecture, for example. What's your mix of internal and external firewalls? Do you and does your network team actually understand the rules that are deployed on those? So from the network phase, we're trying to look at these historical metrics to figure out what the proposed busy time or proposed real-time traffic is and how that fits from your busy time on that network. If we don't have that historical number about their WAN utilization or their LAN utilization, it's really hard for us to put our number into that metric and come to something real or come to something that we want to test to.
Right, because as we're modeling and we get into the phase, there's going to be one of two approaches. You're going to either have, as we have here, propose based off of desired number of concurrency and usage, or figure out how much we can do in what's remaining of the network. But we can't do either of those without historical metrics to show us what is available on the pipe.
Right. If we're starting from a point of not getting any historical metric, you run a real risk, even in running the network assessment, of overloading your network. Okay. We move into phase two here of this, and it is modeling. When we talk about modeling, what we really talk about is using the bandwidth calculator in performing this network assessment. It's a set of basic tasks that cover defining your sites, taking that information you gathered in your discovery phase, and popping it into the bandwidth calculator. You define your WAN links and your bandwidth for each site, what bandwidth is available for those RTC traffic or that UC traffic on that link, what internet link that bandwidth has, or what is the bandwidth for the internet link at the central site. So as people are coming in and connecting from the outside, how's that impacted? You create or update those personas. So those are the usage personas of how many calls per minute the people have, how many video calls, how much real-time traffic, how much collaboration traffic they have. You define the number of users per site, and then you plug those numbers in and get to analyze the numbers that it spits out at you. The bandwidth calculator is available for download here. It says it's a Lync 2010 and 2013, and it is one unified tool that understands both the capabilities of 2010 and 2013. And there's a Word document accompanying that tool that explains how to use it and what to go through on.
Right, and that document does update on a regular basis. So as more logic or features and things are added into the product, it needs to evolve as well. So if you have an older version, get the latest, just get it from the link.
Yep, go and download the latest. This is just a quick little screenshot here of what we've got from a network perspective. You've got on the left-hand side here, you've got your central sites and your branch sites defined in that sites tab. You've got your WAN link info specified about how those things connect and what percentage of that is allocated to real-time traffic. This one up here, that Phoenix central site, they're allocating a good half of their WAN to real-time traffic. That's higher than most places I've seen.
Yeah, so that is abnormal. But hey, if you have it and that's what you're defined as, because it as a central site, you may be bringing back a bunch of additional locations. And if you look at their branches, there's three of them that are coming back through the Phoenix central site. So maybe they need it.
Yep.
But this is where maybe fun is the
it's
right word.
Understanding.
But you can understand the network, plug in numbers, change it, see, if I can get another 20 megabit, I can get another 150 calls. If I drop it by that, then
I've got to limit my calls.
The number of calls, right?
In that way.
Yep.
So we move on to phase three. Phase three is where we really simulate that traffic. It's about putting real traffic on your network at the anticipated load that Lync is going to put on that network. And we expect you during this deployment to simulate that for what we call an extended period of time. A week is a good starting point for that assessment. If you know that you've got network processing that happens on a specific week, I would actually encourage you to run your network assessment during that specific week. If you know that you've got a monthly report running that runs, you know, for the last 3 days of the month, every month, maybe we should run our network assessment during that week, even though it's a little risky for you. It is good to understand what that's going to do when you actually deploy Lync on that same network.
That's right. And the longer the better. 1 week, we're saying 7 days, 24 hours, go for it, minimally. But if you can get 31 days, that's better. Right?
Yeah.
If you can get a full cycle and get every peak and valley that you're going to have, then you'll know. You're not going to know until you run the assessment what your network's actually doing. And so being able to gather that data is going to be highly important.
Yep. We expect the simulation to handle or to happen under normal load on your network. We don't expect you to run this simulation when you've sent all your employees home for the week.
Right.
The simulation does simulate Lync traffic flows, so it simulates both P2P calling, conference calling, PSTN, so on. When we're talking about why, right, this is about the fact is, only under stress will the network reveal how it actually operates. Inside of that WAN you've got, your guys may tell you they have X amount of bandwidth, but truth is they have 20% of that and they can burst all the way up to that, but when they burst, it gets buffered or what have you. And the truth is, without pushing the congestion down that network, there's no buffering, so no jitter and no packet loss. But once we start pushing the network to its limit, we get the congestion and we get the jitter, we get the packet loss. So the truth is, we need to simulate link network traffic because no real traffic exists.
All right.
So from a how perspective, we would expect this to happen for a week, 24 hours a day. This does mean, though, that somebody has to be effectively on call to stop, interrupt, interact with this service to understand, or to, if it is causing harm to your network.
Right.
As we say, it's just like link traffic. It's real, and there can be a lot of it.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about it, it's very possible that your network team doesn't know what they don't know, and if they're in the assumption that things are running fine, and yet you're at 98% capacity already, and you kick up this process that's going to eat up another 15 to 20% of the bandwidth that you think is there, you could impact business, real business. And that's where having a kill switch really quick to stop things from happening is highly important.
Yeah, but as we say, it can harm your network. You should know that. And truthfully, a lot of this hinges on QoS or DSCP settings and sort of how that fits. You need to really understand what your customer has deployed or what they think they've deployed from a quality of service onto their network as you're deploying this to ensure that the network testing that you're doing fits into what Lync will fit into once it's deployed on that same network. So our fourth phase here is about recommendations and sort of how this comes at the end of this network assessment. We have a set of possible outcomes and recommendations that come out of this network assessment. It'll provide guidance on where to upgrade those WAN links if necessary. It'll provide guidance on where to improve your network with respect to latency, jitter, packet loss, things like that. It'll provide input into the link design process. It'll test if your expectations for the number of concurrent calls or the workloads that you're deploying or the centralized or decentralized infrastructure that you're planning on deploying is the correct one for the network.
Yeah, and you'll notice on this slide we talk about the guidance that Microsoft's giving. From the Microsoft perspective, as mentioned, it's not a networking company. The product is not a networking product in the sense of making the changes to the environment. Simply, this is what we're seeing. This is being caused at this specific point. This is what should be fixed. How you fix it's up to the client to determine based off of their expertise and their why things are designed the way they're designed. And there may not be a fix. And it may be the opposite. Okay, Lync won't work in this location.
So right? Let's put in the policies to make Lync not work at that location.
Exactly.
So these are all possible outcomes of this network assessment. One value add that we don't really talk about out of the network assessment is QoS validation. Mm-hmm. So you go into a customer and they're saying that they have, you know, quality of service applied on all their MPLS networks. They have network quality of service defined end to end, and you can come in, perform this network assessment, and show to them that markings are getting dropped on specific MPLS links for those customers, and It's really a big value add for them to be able to go back to their service provider and say, hey, what the...
All right. Or not. I mean, it is possible that things are working. I mean, it's validation. But so either way, they know.
This will check it.
Right.
Right. So one way quality of service is an interesting one, that because of that MPLS links potentially not having those QoS markings, one way QoS can provide a very strange end user experience.
All right. Yeah, somebody's traffic's getting there like it's supposed to on time, the others is not. You have all kinds of weird jitter and buffer issues. One way, not both ways. It's interesting.
So to recap what this network assessment is all about, it's about doing that discovery. It's about understanding what network exists and how that exists at your customer or at your client or at your site for that matter. It's about usage modeling, understanding what we propose based on the usage model that we think Lync is going to take, based on those user profiles and personas. It's about performing that true network UC simulation using a piece of software that simulates and puts real-time traffic on your network, tagged and marked in the ways that Lync will be doing it. And then it provides this final set of recommendations that will let you analyze those factors that could affect quality and produce a full report with recommendations for how you might rectify those things. So we have a Lync conference coming up here in Lync Conference 2014, happening in Las Vegas, Nevada, February 18th to the 20th this year. We're expecting a really good turnout. You can go ahead and register at lyncconf.com. And with that, thank you for attending this course on Lync 2013 Ignite, the Lync Updates and Programs.